Smart choices. Had a girlfriend once. That was like 20 years ago. She would tell her kid, make smart choices. That used to irk me. And I would say to myself, if she ever talks to me that way, she's fired. And one day she talked to me that way. She got fired. Anyway, good habits. It was about good habits. And we have Matt. He's going to talk about good habits at the table, RPG wise.
Matt Mutrigrosso here, creator of Xenoplicity and the Q system it runs on. In a previous video, I had talked about bad habits to have at the table, and so let's talk about good habits to have at the table in this video.
So I'm curious if these are going to be habit-forming habits or innate habits, latent habits. Influenced habits, inherent habits, assumed habits. What is it called when you're born with habits? What is that called? What's the name of that? Not evolved. What is that called? Genetic habits. I guess the thing I try is during a session, I don't even know what it's called now. Session minus two. What is a practice session called when you just want to see if someone can role play or not? Minus two? Minus one. Minus one is when you're talking about what kind of game to run. Zero, I guess, is when you're making your characters. Introducing your characters, have more than one session, zero, one for each player, and then session one is when the game actually starts and all the players are at the table together. So session minus two. That would be me in a game store for 20 minutes with the player, Futurama player, deciding if they make the cut, if they can do the good habit, if I can teach them good habits in the first 20 minutes of their RPG life, then they can role play for the rest of their life if they learn good habits as soon as possible. Not go to the weirdo table, the guy running the game with the pink hair and the fanny pack and diabetes. Don't go to his table, please. You'll be settling for less for the rest of your life when you do that. Anyway.
Let's kind of have a positive spin for a change,
Yeah,
okay?
positive spin.
So, number one.
Positive spin. Think positive, people. Gosh. We're gonna do this.
If you're a player playing in a game, the first thing you need to make sure you do on a consistent basis at the table is you need to be able to roll your dice with a sense of urgency.
There it is. Matt cuts right to it. That's like the most important thing. Dice are the most important thing in the game. It is a game. So dice are the most important thing, but they're also not that important. If you know what I mean. They introduce tragedy to your game. They introduce emotional damage. How does that guy say that? Emotional damage. Yeah, it adds that to the game. And oh, my brain. My brain's trying to make me sneeze. I'm not going to do it. In a role play session, I don't know if Matt's going to agree with me on this part, but in my games, a 5 hour, let's say a 5 hour game, a maximum session, 5 hours. Each player will roll the dice maybe four times at the max. So in a 5-hour session, each player rolls their dice only four times. Now, they'll roll dice more if they're doing damage to something. But for the most part, they're rolling their dice four times in 5 hours. That seems kind of not enough. Yeah, each player is rolling less than once an hour. Does that make sense? 4 out of 5. So that's less die rolls per hour. Or that's less than one die roll per hour. How does that work? So it sounds inconceivable. But let's say you have four players at your table. There's going to be die rolling. So each hour, almost all the players have rolled dice at least once on average. That's enough die rolls, don't you think? Now, I save die rolls for when it's super, super important. I don't do die rolls just every couple of turns. You know, everyone roll for perception. Everyone do spot hidden rolls. No, I don't do that nonsense. Everyone do a lore knowledge roll. No. That's what you do to players that aren't playing the game. They're just there to roll dice for your little story generator that you're reading to them. Now, the players are role-playing. They roll dice when it's super, 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 something important, like something horrific or good could happen that they're doing, or something interesting can result from what they're doing, or it gives my NPCs damage that I can use later against them. You know, I can weaponize my NPCs depending on how their characters roll. So the character makes a roll, they succeed in doing the thing, but my NPCs know about it. So they did the thing, but it wasn't totally in secret. The players don't know that I have ammo I can use against them later in the game. And then vice versa. They'll do something, my NPCs just never know about it. The players got away with it. Anyway, the point is, you don't want the dice to interrupt the roleplay. You don't want to say to Joe, "Oh, make a such and such roll for me, please." Be like Atlas in BioShock. Was that the guy's name? Can you so kindly roll dice for me? You know, stuff like that. And then, of course, the player's going to slow down. They're going to take their time. They're going to do this with the dice. They're going to do this for like a minute. And then they go, just fucking roll the dice. Don't even make a deal about it. Just pick them up and drop them. Pick them up and drop. Break its legs, walk away, kind of a thing. And react quickly to what you just did. Narrate quickly what your character is doing afterwards. Don't stop the game just because someone needs to make a die roll. It's so rare. That's why you gotta race to the game store. Do it now. Before COVID 2.0 happens. Race to the game store. And meet and greet. New people actually want to role play. If they're just there to do magic cards or board game, skip. But if they're there to role play, grab them, sit them down at the table, do some role play for 20 minutes with them, get their names, and because we got to do something. The weirdos are taking over the hobby. It's getting harder and harder and harder. to find regular dudes and dudettes that want to do the roleplay thing.
Okay, what do I mean by that? I mean, when it's your turn to go, don't spend 30 seconds to a minute shaking your dice before you roll them. This is one of those things that really gets under my skin.
That's Abraham. Abraham, when he's rolling for an NPC. Really? For an NPC? I want to win. I want my NPC to win.
I don't understand why some players do this, but they really do. They really drag it out.
Yahtzee. So
they'll get their dice together.
Yahtzee. I want to say, Max, that Legion of Myth uses a cup. Yahtzee.
They'll get their dice and they'll go. And they'll just keep doing this. And then they'll maybe start.
What are those things called? Hang on. Let me check. These things. Players are at the table acting like they have these in their hand. Stop it.
Start to just roll, and then they'll go back to rolling. Enough already. Just roll the dice. Like, literally, this is it. Done. That's it. You should be able to roll your dice in 5 seconds or less.
How do I do it? I'm on the clock. Driscoll, what are you doing?
What am I rolling for?
Okay. Random dice, right? Get out of the way, mouse. Hey, just if they're already on the mouse pad, I just pick them up, drop them. I got a 2 and a 3, 6 and a 1, 2 and a 3, 5 and a 3, you know. 1 and a 6. It's not rocket science, I tell you. Just pick them up, close your fist, open the fist. They bounce once or twice on the mouse pad, done.
Yes. And even that's a big window to throw some dice, okay? Don't drag this out, okay? Roll the dice, then very quickly calculate your result, whatever system you're using, okay? Sometimes you're just looking to beat a target number.
Mongoose Traveler, 2nd edition, part-time.
Number. Sometimes you're counting successes. Whatever, it doesn't matter, whether it's a dice pool or whether it's a single die or you know, whatever. Have your dice ready, roll those dice, and then announce your result. And do it quickly and efficiently. Don't drag it out, okay? You have to understand that every aspect of a tabletop role-playing game takes X amount of time. And so when you add up X here.
Here we go. What about when the DM says, "What do you do?" You're gonna add up how much time in someone's lifetime they've spent saying, "What do you do? What do you do?"
Going to end up eating up the time at your game table, right? So if you want to get through a lot of material, if you want to have a lot of progress in your game session, you can't like dilly dally about a lot of these little steps. You have to have a sense of urgency about it at your table, right? So do that. And kind of on that same point, know what you want to do when it's your time to act, okay? In most tabletop role-playing games, you get to go, and then after you go, another player will go, and then another player, and maybe between those players, some NPCs will get to act as well. So you have a lot of time.
Yep, exactly. Sometimes NPCs get to go because sometimes the NPCs are already doing something. They're Gordon, I'm rather busy right now. You know, that's an NPC. What is it now, Gordon? You know, Barney goes off and he does something. Hey there, Mr. Freeman. Getting off early, are you? And then you hear the explosions. And Ruika, and then Barney starts shooting at one of them. And then you hear the alarm going off, the strobe light, Head crabs. Scientists with head crabs are coming out of the elevator. It's cool stuff. Anyway, players should take no more than a minute. No more than a minute to do their turn. No more. I mean, if they're taking a minute to do their move, something's horribly wrong. Someone's not paying attention. There's a problem in the mist. 30 seconds. 30 seconds is my threshold, I guess. If a player can't say what their character is doing in 30 seconds, what is going on? It's like, Shanner, why did you bring this person to our game? But yeah, Matt's right. As soon as someone's done with their turn, boom, it's the next person's turn. In our case, it's whatever player makes sense to go next. Who has the opportunity? Sometimes it's a free-for-all. You got players talking over each other. When that happens, the players are doing the things at the same time. But for the most part, people just take turns. If a player doesn't say anything, they're probably unconscious. If they're not with the party, they're still going to say what they're doing. They're somewhere else, but they're still saying what they're doing. Now, if not, everyone's going to, like I said before, hardly any die rolls in my games. So players can just talk, not talky-talky. But roleplay. They're doing something important. They're not just chit-chatting about nonsense. They're doing something. Usually life and death situations. And when it gets interesting enough, one of the players gets a chance to save the day, or not. And we'll stack help. You know, players can help with a task to make sure that the final roll succeeds. You know, they spend a good, you know, it's like the A team. They've spent a good 10 minutes doing the thing, getting it ready. It should work. It better work. It will work. This must work. We only have one chance at this. That kind of thing. That's when you roll the dice. And you use a die mechanic that makes sense. Don't use a fucking D20 luck die. Stop using luck dice. Characters are so your archetypes are so supposedly role playing in a game, and then they make the roll to save the day, and they're using a D20 die. Really? Good luck with that.
To calculate and think about what it is you want to do when it's your turn to go again. Okay.
Here's the thing, yeah. Before the player says what they're going to try to do, what they're attempting to do, they better have an idea of what their skill role is going to be already in their mind, and what modifiers they're going to be using. Me, if I'm running the game, I'm going to mention a modifier, like basically a boon or a bane. But the players know ahead of time. If they're doing everything on an ice slick road, and it's slippery as fuck, that's a bane. Everything they try to do is going to be a bane, as long as they're on that ice lake or whatever, and they don't have proper shoes while they're on the ice. Or what would be another thing? The players. I let the players do the pluses and minuses. There's not very many in the system I use. So usually it's just going to be, if they're aiming, then they get a plus on their next turn when they shoot. If someone's crouching, that's a minus to someone else trying to shoot at them. Anyway, I have a feeling he's going to say all the good habits. Basically, this video, I'm going to bet this video is just another video on how to roleplay. And there's not a whole lot of them on the internet. You can count them on like four hands. That's it. On all of YouTube, there's hardly any videos on how to roleplay and how to do the mechanics of roleplay.
So it is inappropriate and really inconsiderate to be disengaged the whole time it's not your turn.
Oh, and
when
that.
It comes back to you.
Shauna, it's your turn. Already? What'd you guys do so far? I was contemplating my navel. What did you guys do now? Where are you all at? Whose turn was it last? What did he do? Where am I at? Where's my character? Oh, that would suck. That would be a horrific nightmare.
Your turn. You're clueless about what it is you want to do. And so
also on the other side of the coin, you got the player, right? Who's already got in their head, they're metagaming for a brief moment in time. What kind of die roll they're going to make? Because they're going to stay in their turn. They're on their turn. They're ready to do the thing. This has been building up for the last 8-9 minutes. They're getting ready to do the thing. And so the player's got an idea. What he's going to do in character. What role he has to make. He's been given the go. He's been given the green light. Green light, when the referee gives the green light, that's basically letting the characters know the difficulty of something. And the players are like, yes. And they're already figuring out ways to beat the difficulty level. So when it's their turn, boom, they roll, they add their stuff, and they tell me the success or failure. Varying degrees of success and failure. I'll either narrate that or I let the players narrate that. Depends on what kind of game we're running, what's the tone, the mood, the theme, all that kind of stuff. And also, before I say what a difficulty level is for something, I better sure as fuck have an idea in mind for when the players pass or fail their little quizzes. I don't want them to say, I win. And then I'm like, what kind of booby prize should I give the player now? I'm thinking of, so he rolled a critical success. I need to have like three or four outcomes already in my mind when I announce a difficulty level, whether it's easy or impossible and all in between. I need to already know. So I already need to have some answers for what they roll. So I can just shoot it off. I can just narrate right away, describe right away what happens or what the outcome is or what the consequences are. If it's a hidden difficulty that the players just don't know, I don't give them the difficulty. I know what it is. The players don't. I still need to know what the outcome is going to be depending on what they roll. Players don't want to see me looking in the book. Oh, let's see. You rolled a 7. So 7 is a... So that means it's a... And then I'm adding my... You know... My difficulty level was a 10 and you rolled a 7 and don't do that. Don't be that GM. Already know in your mind. Know the outcome first, the various outcomes before picking and stating a difficulty level to the players. And at the same time, before the players do their thing, they need to sure as hell know, what they're rolling for. What's the character freaking doing? So you know how their role's gonna be. Well, what skill are they using? What attribute are they cranking out at the moment? And the best part of all this, the best part, is when The player knows their character can't do what they're trying to do. And the player's going to try anyway. Because critical failure can be glorious when you're role-playing. Absolutely glorious. So me, if I'm running the game, I have to be thinking ahead. If they fail at this, I have to have some amazing narration to say what event now occurs. I'm not so much saying what happens to the character or what the character does. I'm just describing events as they occur. Whoever's nearby might get their ass kicked or damaged in some way. An area of effect may occur. Oftentimes in bad ways. And I gotta have something. Let's say there was no way out. They're in this dungeon, whatever. There's no way out. There's no escape. They try something. It's a critical failure. Something blows up. Some players might get their asses kicked. Anyway, there's a chain reaction blow up thing. Now there's a fucking hole. An escape route. If they're still alive. There's now an escape route out of the dungeon. That kind of thing can happen.
You just kind of hem-haw around about what it is you want to do. Oh, do I want to do this? Do I want to do this? Like, I have had players that they've just, I don't know, whatever they were doing, they weren't paying attention. And when it got back to their turn, they needed a recap of what had happened before they could act. And then, or
yeah. Oh, that's me back in the GURPS days, where players would take forever doing their turns. Guys would get up, get themselves a pizza slice, some soda, Mountain Dew preferably, and they'd be chowing down. And they come to the table, or they go out and take a smoke break, and they come back, and they'll say, "What happened? What's going on? Whose turn is it?" I used to be in those games. I used to run those kinds of games, not knowing any better. We're all having fun, right? Yeah.
Or another example of this would be maybe you were paying attention, but then when it gets to be your turn, you're indecisive about one or two different things that you can do. So you sit there and kind of start to weigh the options, and then
analysis paralysis. My character, I think I'll try a yap.
And the worst is when you start asking other players for advice on what to do.
Oh no.
Don't do this, okay?
No, no, stay in character. It's like that guy when he says, stay on target. He's basically saying, stay in character. And don't ask for a lifeline or a 50-50. Don't do that. And don't have a co-GM at the table who says to all the players, you should do this. I recommend you try this. If your character sheet has this on it, you should probably do this. Your chances of survival are better if you do this. So I used to have players like that. They were the outspoken ones. You got the quiet, mealy mouth types who don't say much during the game. And then you got the guy who's been role-playing for 30 years, you know. Good God. Worst players ever. Anyway, they'll open up their mouth and they always... When it's not their turn, they're always suggesting what the other players do.
Okay. Don't ask another player how to play your character. You play your character. And don't let other players tell you how to play your character. Don't let other players try to guide you in what you should do. Forget all that nonsense. You decide what you're going to do. And if it comes down to one or two options, then make a decision and roll with it. Okay, it doesn't have to be the perfect option. You just need to make sure you throw out an option and then you run with it, that you go with it, that you commit to it. Okay, again, have a sense of urgency for the dice rolling, have a sense of urgency for declaring your action and making your turn. Don't drag it out, right? If you need to look up what a spell does in a spell book, like for whatever game you're playing, do that when it's not your turn. Okay, have quick page references written on your character sheet, or take screenshots, like pictures on your...
Yeah, in the back of your character sheet, you have spells. or psionic powers or magic abilities, whatever. It's all the same fucking thing. Just different words. Write those down. So you don't have to look them up in the book to see what the power does. And if you know, if you have cliff notes, what is it? Shortcuts or whatever, write that down. Don't write down the whole paragraph. Just write down the gist. This power uses two health points. And it lasts for 20 minutes, something like that. You don't have to write all the nonsense about its origins, where the magic comes from, how the magic works. It doesn't matter. That would be like writing down, oh, here's my guns and bullets. And you don't write down how the gun works, how you take it apart and put it back together. You don't write down how the trigger makes the thing do its stuff. You don't write down how to aim the weapon. You don't write down, you might write down how much the gun weighs, but you're not going to write down what it's made of, how much it costs. You're just going to write down, for gun, you're going to write down how far it shoots, and how many dice of damage does it do? That's it. If you're really bored, you could draw the gun next to the gun name and show it off to your friends. I'm an artist. I went to what was that website, gunnut.com or something, and it just generates random guns that you can copy paste as clip art.
Phone of the various spells that you're going to choose from, and that way you can be looking at them if your table allows cell phones at the table. But otherwise, have quick references wrote down, like page numbers on your character sheet, and be looking those things up when it's not your turn. And so that way, when it gets to be your turn, you know exactly.
Okay, see how he's got these white dots in his pupils? That's how you know someone's an AI. Knowing is half the battle.
Exactly what you want to do, and you know how those spells work. And it doesn't have to be spells. It can be special abilities, special powers, whatever game you're playing. It all depends on the game. But there's going to be special abilities and special little powers that come with a lot of different tabletop role-playing games. So whatever you need to look up, do it when it's not your turn. Do it in advance. Know what your character is capable of. And that way you're not in this state of indecisiveness and cluelessness when it's your turn to act, okay? And again, these little minutes that you lose here and there, they add up.
They right? add up.
It boggles my mind.
They add up. And then you got players that don't. Then you have players who are not even proactive. That adds up. So you end up in a tavern for 2 hours in your game session. Boring as hell.
Sometimes where a game session on some games may, you know, you get together, you're excited to play the night, and then at the end of the night, you got through like one room of a dungeon or one fight.
Oh my God, shoot me now. Maybe
just two rooms.
Kill me.
You know, of some kind of like, you know, big game that you're playing. Or maybe just one kind of encounter is all that you got through. And everyone's left scratching their heads like, man, we really didn't get far. A lot of the reason you don't is because you're wasting time at the table. So don't do that. Don't waste people's time. Don't waste your time, right? If everybody is quick and efficient with their turns, then you can go around the table faster. Everybody gets to act more. You get to progress farther into the game. You're going to get more done. That normally means more experience at the end of the game session, depending on the game you're playing. And even if not more experience, even if your game doesn't work that way, you still have more fun because you got to do more and have more engagement, all right, and interact more with the game and with each other. So in every aspect, the game improves when the players are all focused and they all have a sense of urgency about what it is they're doing. And they're not indecisive about what they're going to do on their turn. right? Nothing kills momentum more than a player when it gets to be their turn and everyone's excited and the game master says, all right, so-and-so, what are you doing? And the player's like, I don't know. I just don't know. You want to talk about killing momentum? You want to talk about bringing the fun down at the table? That's how you do it, okay? So don't do that. So again, the positive takeaway to this is have a sense of urgency. Know what you want to do. Be decisive about what your character is going to do in that moment, okay? And then just roll with it. Just do it, okay? Another thing that you can do if you want to have a good habit at the table is have some energy, okay? Again, no one wants a downer, okay? You need to have, excitement and be energetic at the table.
Yeah, you want an interesting character. If your character has flaws, make the flaws interesting. Don't be Eeyore unless you can make Eeyore interesting in a game.
Right? Bring the table up. Really in any kind of social situation, you're either improving the environment or you're dragging it down. There's no neutral ground because people feed off of each other, right? So if you want a table that has a lot of excitement and that has a lot of fun that's being sparked and generated at that table, then you need to be doing your part to bring the energy.
Remember the bad guy in RoboCop? He gets beat up by RoboCop because he knows RoboCop can't kill him. So RoboCop proceeds to just throw him through plate glass window. And the guy says, "What is this shit?" as he's being thrown through like the third or fourth pane of glass. And then they cut to the next scene where RoboCop just throws him at what are those guys called? The duty officer or the sheriff office, one of the sheriff, anyway, throws him at the guy's podium, and he spits up a bunch of blood on the DM's DM screen and says, "Just give me my fucking phone call." See, that's an interesting way of your characters getting their ass kicked. They're all bloody and beaten to a pulp. And instead of the player getting all down and out about it, "Oh my God, you're killing my character here," and they start getting pissed, getting a little pissy, they can still keep the role play of that character interesting by saying, the guy, what does the guy say? He says, "Name." And he's, and when it's the other guy's turn, he says, I straighten my glasses and I look at him and I just spit out a tooth in front of him on his desk and I say, "Just give me my fucking phone call." You want to keep your character? You want to stay in character? You want to keep, if you had an interesting character to start with in the game, your character should stay interesting through the whole session. Don't just make your character become characterless as the game goes, to the point where no one remembers what your character even is by the end of this session because you're not really saying where you're at and what you're doing. That's called a boring ass role player when you never say where your character is and what your character's doing when it's your fucking turn. Like, what are you doing at the table besides asking the GM a million questions about nonsense? What the fuck are you at the table for? Did you bring a character?
Right? Don't come into the game session in a bad mood and because you had a bad day at work.
That's true. I've done that. I'm guilty. I am guilty of going to game sessions in a bad mood. Because I don't give a rat's ass about the game session and I'm ruining everyone else's fun. I was that person. Back in 89, I was that person.
Right? Or you had a rough week or whatever. Like, don't bring that into your game session. Leave that at the door, right? When you get together with your friends, you're there to have fun. So make the most of that. Be positive, be energetic, be upbeat. And if there's someone else that's kind of down and dragging, do what you can to lift them up too. But at the end of the day, like sometimes the game master just needs to have a talk like, dude, like you're bringing everybody down. Like you have to stop that. You have to have excitement and you have to be happy at the table. And you're going to find that if everyone at your table is energetic and excited and engaged on this level, then you're just going to have a better night. Because inevitably one person, you know, that's like sapping the energy out of the room can really make that table turn cold very quick.
That's true. Also, the other players probably had a bad day as well. And they're holding it in. They're keeping it together. And they're thinking, gosh, Driscoll's not keeping it together. I wonder what's going on. What's happened to him? Normally he's like, anyway. Yep. I remember those days.
Okay. And you don't want that. So that's not good. Another good habit to have is be a good sport. Okay. When something doesn't go your way in the game, so what? It's a game, right? Don't lose your attitude because you roll poorly, right? I mean, I'll tell you what, there have been some nights where statistically it shouldn't have happened, but there have been nights where one or two players have just rolled the worst consecutive rolls, turn to turn, encounter to encounter that I have ever seen in my life. And it's like, it kind of blows your mind. You're like, how is this even happening? Like statistically, if you were to do the math, you'd be like, this should not be possible.
Yeah. Last night I rolled six sixes. And I was like, that's never going to happen again. I don't remember the last time I've ever rolled six sixes at the same time.
That you could screw up this much, you know, with the dice rolling. You know, it seems like there are some nights when nothing goes your way at the table. Or the opposite of that, there are some nights where the game master, they are just firing on all cylinders and every roll they make seems to be a critical hit.
Yeah, that was me. That was me doing the critical hit stuff. What was I? I was trying out. Oh, I got a bunch of games from Drive-Thru. Cashing in my credit, buying games and trying out mechanics and stuff. There's a lot of free stuff right now on Drive-Thru also.
You know, or just a critical success. And so it's like, man, how can I beat this guy? How can I stop this NPC when like the game master just keeps rolling such great rolls? Like what on earth? And this is the fun of a game that has dice in it, right? Because, you know, yeah, law of averages typically works, but there are times when the dice just kind of, they're just going to guide that game down some kind of crazy, weird direction that statistically just don't make a lot of sense. But that's part of the fun of it, that you don't know how it's going to go. And so don't rob yourself of that by losing your attitude when things are going poorly. Just embrace it. Embrace the ride, right? Not every part of life is fun, but you can still enjoy it, okay? And that's something.
Oh, and then a few days ago it happened when in Traveler 5, I rolled five ones, and that's a crit. That's a critical success, rolling five ones like that. Like, that's never going to happen.
Something that players really need to wrap their minds around and embrace, okay? All gamers need to do this on some level. You know, and if you do this, then you find that no matter whether your character has a good night or a bad night, you can still have fun as a player because you're there with your friends and a story is unfolding throughout these things. And sometimes that story can be tragic or funny, or it even, there are times where it will border on slapstick because of how many things will go wrong with a certain character. But again, your table can either embrace that and have fun with it and like look back fondly on that as like the night where nothing went right in the, you know, in the game. Or you can lose your attitudes about it and you can like, you know, get all upset and you can like, you know, get all, you know, huffy and puffy. I got to tell you, I would much rather be at a table that does the former, okay? And so have that kind of attitude at your table. You're going to be positive. You're going to be upbeat. You're going to have fun no matter what the dice roll. It's going to be fun and enjoyable because you're with your friends. You're with people.
Yeah, that's the thing. In the games I was in, it's just randos. I'll know one or two people at the table, but there's always like one or two other players I've never seen before. And the minute it's their turn, I just know I'm in for some shit storm game session. And I'm already looking at the clock to see when I can get sprung from this session.
That are have a shared interest, a shared hobby, and you're just there to have a good time, okay? Another thing you can do that's a good habit, bring drinks, bring snacks, okay? If someone's going to order a pizza, offer to ship in and throw some money at whoever's ordering it.
Yeah, always have money with you. Always pay for whatever's being delivered. Always have money with you. Don't be that guy who's just, like a looter. Just, he's a freeloader.
I can't tell you guys, I usually host game night in my house. But there have been times throughout my gaming experience where we've alternated it and done it at other people's houses. And, you really should have something to offer people if you're hosting the event, okay? Think of it like getting together with your friends to do any number of things, right?
Yeah, I'll call up and say, what do you need me to bring? What do you need? Books? Food? Computer? Back then we would use our home computers as GM screens and stuff. Let's say, we need another Switch. Do you have a Switch? Bring a Switch. And bring a cable. Power strip. Okay.
You're going to have company over to your house. You need to be able to offer them something, right? Don't have nothing prepared. There have been times where I've showed up at somebody's house and they had nothing. There were no snacks.
No extra Rubbermaid chairs. Always bring an extra Rubbermaid chair.
There was no drinks. And so it was you can get some tap water. Well, okay. It's not that it's mandatory, but it's just polite. It's just being hospitable,
Find out what people drink. Don't buy a bunch of RC Cola or Yubba Bubba or whatever it's called. Don't buy that crap. Find out what the players drink. If I know it's going to be a shitstorm, I'll just come in with my own. Bring your own drink. Bring your own food. It's they're going to be eating that vegetable hamburger meat crap. Oh, my God. I'm going to bring some. I'll eat before I come over. That kind of thing.
Don't be that guy that has nothing to offer people when they show up. I'm not saying you have to go crazy and splurge. But a way to help someone out, because again, this can be expensive, right? If you host game night week to week, it's a lot of money. It's a lot of money to stock your fridge with soft drinks and to buy bags of chips. I mean, nowadays, especially with the price of chips, you're for one bag of chips, which don't last long, you're spending $5, So, if you're going to show up at a person's house, and you're going to enjoy their home,
but here's the thing. There's a high percentage of a chance that the players at the table voted for a cost of living increase. I guarantee it. A whole hell of a lot of the players at the table voted for a higher cost of living. Every time they vote, that's what they vote for. So I have issues. I have issues with communists at the table. I have issues.
And they're hosting the event. Then do your part. Bring a 12-pack. Bring a 2-liter. Bring a bag or two of chips with you that you stopped and got at the gas station on the way over, right? It's not much, but it adds. It contributes. It shows that you're appreciative and thankful that you're being welcomed into their home, right? And this is nice. This is a good habit to have. Okay. So do that, you know, help the person out that's hosting, and kind of go along with that, offer to host. Okay. Don't, if there's one person that's always hosting the event, that they're always the one making their home available. I got to tell you something.
Yeah. That's kind of weird. If the same person is doing it all the time. Or the same person is always running the game. I like it when players take turns running games.
There are times where that's easier to do than other nights. I got a wife and I got kids. You know, do your part, right, by offering to host from time to time, because you know, it can be a real challenge sometimes to host an event. And so if people are sharing in that load and they're not always putting that burden on one person's shoulders, that can make a big difference with your gaming group. Okay. Again, it's just about being, you know, hospitable. It's about, you know, having gratitude in your heart about, you know, being part of a group that you want to contribute. Okay. So offer to host from time to time. You don't have to do it every week, but offer that, you know, offer up your apartment or your house to host a game night, right? And then when people show up, have something to offer them. And everybody can bring something, and then, you know, it's kind of like a little potluck. If everybody brings something, then, you know, the table's full of things to choose from. And you can have a great time with your friends, and it doesn't cost any one person a lot of money. Okay. So that's a good thing. Another good habit is be willing to game master. Be willing to try that out. Okay, there's all kinds of stories online where you can read about how, and really kind of, it's kind of like a running joke, I think, among the forever gamers that have played a long time, that most of us know on some level, those of us that are really dedicated to the hobby, oftentimes we get stuck into the forever game master role, right?
Yep. Yep.
That's not good.
That's not good.
It's bad for a lot of reasons. Number one, it creates burnout. If you're always stuck game mastering, and don't get me wrong, game mastering is a lot of fun. Okay. I love to game master. It's something that I really enjoy. But if you're always stuck in the same role at the table, you can burn yourself out. Okay. It can really wear on you, because you never get to experience the joy of playing a character in the game. You never get to be a player character.
So I'm 50-50. 50-50 that I'll run the game or I'll be a player. I don't want to always be a player or always be running a game.
You're always fulfilling the role of the game itself and of the world. And while that has its own benefit, and it should not be a chore, it's good to have a little diversity. It's good to switch things up from time to time. And from a practical level too, if you want people to stay in the hobby, you want people that are invested in the hobby, right? Because people, the more they're invested in something, the longer they're going to stick with it.
Yeah, and you don't want people who just come over because you have food. The only reason why they're there is to eat your food. Or they don't care what the game is. It doesn't matter. Whatever. It's game night. I don't care. I'm coming over. Whatever games, I don't know. Doesn't matter to me what game we play. I don't want that. I don't want that person.
And so if you're going to play this game week to week, buy your own books. Invest in the hobby.
Yep.
Be willing to game master. Be willing to switch the roles up.
Yep.
You don't need to run a perfect game to get started. All you need to do is be willing to try. And I got to tell you, there's this weird kind of phobia people get where they can play a game for years and they never, ever want to try out game mastering it themselves. And this is bad for the.
Yeah. When I was a kid, I used to think, gosh, he runs the game. He must be a freaking genius. But as I got older, I noticed that, oh my God, this game sucks. This GM doesn't know what he's doing. This is like one of the worst sessions I've sat at. This guy running the game, it's taken him forever. Why is he, yes, what? I can think of better things to happen in this session than what he's narrating is happening. When you get to that point, you know you're ready. You know you're fucking ready to start running games.
Hobby. I've talked about this in another video. It is good when everybody is cross-trained at the table. If you have game masters that also get to play characters, and you have players that also game master from time to time, you're going to find that your table has a much greater cohesiveness to it. You're going to find that those players, if they've ever game mastered before, they tend to be better players. They tend to be more focused. They tend to pay more attention. They tend to be more respectful. They tend to have a better...
They're invested in the hobby. They don't mind being a player. Some GMs, they really just want to be the GM. They like to control other people. They're that kind of a GM. And they have a fear of just being one of the players. They don't have as much control. They think they won't have any control. They think one of the players is going to learn all of his secrets. And then they're going to like him. They're going to like this new person who's running the game more than this other guy who's been a GM his whole life. That's his worst fear.
Perspective about the game in general. They're not just trying to win the game, right? Because they understand the flip side of what's happening at the table. They understand the work and the effort that you put into your session, and so they're going to respect it more. As opposed to a player that all they do is show up and play the game as a player, and they just play one character, they may not have that same level of appreciation, and they tend to not pay as much attention. They tend to be more disruptive, okay? So if you want to have a better table, if you want to have good habits at the table, a great way to encourage that is to get everybody
social contract,
different roles. Another thing you can do is respect people at the table. I
thought he was going to say social contract, because that's what I use. And jazz it up. There's no one single social contract. It has to match the style of game that you run, the type of players you want at your table. The players agree to it. If they don't, they don't get to be at the table. Easy peasy. That's after you've vetted the players. Vetting players is when you're finding out if the guy's a slob. Is he stupid? Is he a retarded stupid head? Is he racist? Is he a nut job that you don't want near your kids? You know, that kind of thing. You know, go to the game store and do that. Do it at a game store. Or do it online or whatever. Don't invite random people to your house. Gosh, you sure have some swell toys here. You know, that kind of thing. But vet the players, find out if it's even worth showing them a social contract. Because that's the next thing. Who knows? Maybe there might be that weird thing where the guy's like, he passes your test, right? He passed with flying colors. He's showing the abilities of role play, and then you show him the social contract. And you say sign on the dotted line here, and they're like, "What is this? What's this? What are you making me sign? What is this? What is this? Some sort of a cultist?" It could happen. I've heard of it happening. It hasn't happened with me yet. Usually, my contracts are written in a way that they're agreed upon because they make fucking sense to the players that want to role play. It's got the things. It's got things that players want to see on there. If they don't, they're like me. They don't want to go to someone's house and no one else is role playing. That's doomsday.
Guys, this is a big one. Okay. Don't talk over someone else at the table, right? If someone else is talking, shut up and listen to them, right? And really pay attention.
Yep.
Don't feel like you always have to be the one talking.
Yep.
Don't talk over people, whether it's a game master or another player. Respect someone else when they're speaking. Okay? Be polite. Be nice. Be a good person.
Yeah, no out-of-character talk helps all of that. All of it.
person at the table, okay? And also pay attention. It's not just don't interrupt. It's also pay attention to what's happening. When it's not your
listening.
Turn, focus on what the other players are doing at the table. Really pay attention to what their characters are saying and doing on their terms.
Be a good listener.
Be engaged. Be engaged at the table. Don't just, you know, kind of like goof off or like doodle or play on your phone.
Yeah, you doodle and then you say, I just go where they go. I'm just going to follow where they go. I'm just going to do what they're doing. For my turn, whatever they decide, I'll just follow along behind. It's like, don't even ask that player what they do, because you just assume they're an NPC that's following them. Worst case scenario, one of the players, maybe more. Most likely more of the players, not just one, are just audience members at the table. They're not there to play. They're just there to laugh it up, have a good time, listen to the smart people in the room role play.
Or whatever it is you're doing. Don't be doing that when it's not your turn. And then when it's your turn, you're clueless or you're oblivious as to what's happened. Don't be that guy, right? Pay attention. When it's the player to your left or to your right, when it's their turn to act, be just as engaged with them and what they're doing as you were when...
And don't hog. Don't hog your turn. You have 30 seconds to say where your character is and what your character's doing. Now, if you're having dialogue with another character, then it's back and forth dialogue. Even then, that back and forth dialogue with another character shouldn't be more than a minute or two. I mean, what are you guys doing? I mean, in a movie, how long does Clint Eastwood talk to another character in a movie? Not long. You know, cut to the chase already.
It was your turn to act. And if you do that to them and they do that to you, well, man, I tell you what, your table is gonna really flow a lot better, okay? And the players are just going to have a lot better time interacting with each other and with you, you know, just in general. Another thing that kind of goes along with this is engage with other characters in the game session. There's a lot of videos online about like the edgelord character, you know, like that kind of dark and brooding character that wants to kind of be off on his own.
I've seen that. The guy doesn't really talk. He doesn't want to be... It's like, I don't know if he has no social skills, if he's shy, if he's just some weird... He just listens to, 80s punk music. That guy. He's the guy that, I mean, we would all show up wearing, you know, punk rock outfits, but this one guy, he just a little bit over the top. He would be the guy who got his face tattooed while the rest of us don't. He would be that guy. And I was like, okay, why is he here? He just got out of prison. He says he role played with Gary Gygax once. So I thought, what the heck? Oh, really? Oh. And don't mention his lazy eye, okay? Okay.
Wants to kind of like hide out in the corner of the tavern and like have shadows all over him and not really talk to anybody, not really want to share any information. If this character, when they learn a secret that the game master intended everybody to know at the table, they tend to keep it to themselves. They don't actually share it the way that you intended them to. This is the kind of character that when the other characters try to talk to them, this character will just clam up and not want to, you know, give out any information about his character to the others at the table. He wants to keep secrets and all this. And here's the problem with this. It's just a terrible way to role play. Okay, this is a game of social interaction. So if you are disengaged and not being part of the group, and
let's say that character is in a movie. What movie would that be where you got a group of characters and then you have this one character who doesn't, you know, he's the man with no name, but to the umpteenth degree. Like, what is his deal? What movie would that be? where one of the main characters is like that, sitting in a corner in the darkness, not saying anything to anybody. What movie would that be that character would be in? Who would see that? Who would watch that movie?
And kind of just isolating yourself in the game. I'm not talking about at the table. You might be super social and interactive with the other players, but in the game, actually in the world's fiction, if that's how you are, well, you're not really engaging with the other characters in a way where the players can role play their characters to the fullest. Because the whole point is that not only are you interacting with NPCs in the world, you're also interacting with each other in the game, okay? So I'm not saying you can't play a character like this, but I am saying that there are limits to what should be acceptable and what's just kind of like rude and really just disruptive gameplay. And again, you know, it's not that it's wrong to have.
I'm hearing crying. Hopefully that's coming from his end, because there's no babies. There's no babies in my realm.
Have a brooding character or a character that's like kind of antisocial, that's fine. But there comes a point where your character has to engage with the setting. They need to be engaged with the other PCs. They need to be engaged with NPCs. And so if in the game, your character...
Yeah, you have encounters with each other. Every time a character opens their mouth towards another character, that's an encounter. It can go fine and dandy, or things can go south real quick, depending on what they say to each other. You know, is the danger room, are the safeties off in the danger room? That's the first thing players want to know before we start a session.
Never wants to talk to anyone and never wants to be a part of anything. And when the group starts to go off on the adventure, you want to hang out and not go with them and then maybe just show up later. There's like you're reaching a point where you're stretching the limits of why the other characters in this setting would want to associate with your character, right? And if you create such a divide between you.
Yeah, that's when let's say the characters are leaving the spaceport except for this one guy who won't go with them, or he's acting all cool, like Charlie Sheen in Ferris Bueller. He thinks he's Joe Cool or something. Just let the player characters leave, do their thing, and then that's when the station guards show up at the spaceport. And they track him down, and they do an ident on the guy, and he's the guy, he's the suspect they've been looking for. So that player character is going off to prison. He's being hauled off. Maybe a fight breaks out. The guards have to kill him. He ends up killing innocent people. He kills the guards. That player had their fun. That player got to have their day in the sun at least. The other players can decide if their characters are going to bail him out of jail or not when they hear word that that's what happened to that guy. Because he never did show up. He never showed up for jury duty like the rest of them did. Something like that. Who knows? Who knows what their mission was? I'm making stuff up.
And the rest of the group, there's not really a good reason in game for them to accept you or to welcome you into the party, you're going to find that it breaks immersion, right? Because there has to be more to it than just, well, we're all sitting at a table together, so we're all stuck together. You know, there has to be in-game reasons why these characters are cohesive.
Okay, they're all at a cafeteria, and they're all ankle chained together. So if one gets up, they all have to get up. Now, if one of the players decides my character's not going with you, I'm not leaving. I'm not leaving the cafeteria. I refuse to go with you guys. That's when he gets a fork stuck in his eye and it goes into his brain. And they pick the lock on his little ankle bracelet thing. And he's just left there real quick to rot. And then the three get up nonchalant to go back on duty. The guards are counting the chained groups, and they notice that, oh, there's only three guys in this group instead of four like they're supposed to be. And that guard goes and looks in the cafeteria to see if there's a lone whatever worker, office worker, who's by himself, because the guard's counting heads, and he sees the guy all, he's been pummeled, stabbed, he's dead, he's all in a corner somewhere bleeding out. And that's when he hits the alarm button. And yeah, that's how you start a game. That's how you start a game, people. And then that player basically just sits there and turns on the Xbox and does something else while other people are playing a game.
And it's not that they can't oppose each other and bicker and fight, right? But there needs to be some level of cohesiveness to the group for them to all adventure together, regardless of the game, right? You know, it's just, it's one of those things where you have to think about that. And so, you know, it's not enough that your player be engaged with the other players at the table. In the fiction of the game, make sure that you're engaging with the material that the Game Master has presented. And this also ties into another thing. Look, if the Game Master has a dungeon prepared for tonight's game session, well, don't be that guy that's going to go everywhere but the dungeon, right? Read the room. You're reading the room. You're seeing what the Game Master is presenting you. Interact with that on some level.
It sounded like there was a big wheel driving around in his living room.
you can have your wanderlust, and you...
Maybe it's the AC. Sometimes my AC kicks in. Okay, now I am hearing kids screaming. How is that possible? I have the video on pause and I'm hearing kids scream. What the heck is going on outside? Human trafficking? Probably.
You can have your open world and sandbox feel without trying to just totally derail the game session. There's a certain level of open worldness that you should have in a game, and it's not that you should be, you know, like ramrodded down one choice or one direction, but you know, I've seen it happen before where it's not that they weren't given choices, but there are some players that no matter what choices are presented, they just want to go with something totally different. So don't be that guy. That's being a bad player. And instead, you know, again, read the room and then focus on something related to what has been presented, okay? And you can, and again, the open worldness is that you can tackle those issues any way you want, right? The Game Master doesn't know or shouldn't know how you're going to handle that situation, but embrace and engage with one of the situations that the Game Master has presented you with on some level, and then take it.
Yeah, usually there's three NPCs. Each one has a story to tell, if asked. You know, I don't want the players asking the GM, what's our quest for tonight? What adventure will we go on to in this session, I wonder? No. There's three NPCs in the room. Players can talk to those characters, find something out that would involve them. Something that the player characters can nip in the bud really quick. Maybe two go with this NPC, two go with this NPC, and they meet up somewhere because both NPCs kind of share the same traumatic experience. They just have a different way of telling it to whoever wants to aid them in recovering. Oh, I don't know. I'm not going to roll on a table to see what it is the players are after. No, it has to make sense with who the NPC is, how the NPC is related to the cave masters, the lizard village rulers, the steampunk floating city, the Mars expedition that failed, you know, depending on the setting, the tone, you know, are these NPCs cultists that have been kicked out? They want their girlfriends back. Their girlfriends were told to stay, but they had to be kicked out. You know, something.
Down whatever direction you and your group take it down, right? So you can still have your freedom of choice. You can still have that kind of like open world feel of like how you're going to deal with it without derailing the session and going in a direction that the game master had no way to prep anything for. That's my advice, okay? So let me know what you guys think. Let me know in the comments below.
Wow, that was a good one. All of Matt's videos are good so far that I've watched.